let's get started. All right, so here we are in May. And unfortunately, Kathy's not with us today. She's homesick, so we all wish her well. Hopes that she's feeling better. She's worked really hard for us every single day, and she's even put together all the notes for the meeting today. So we do wish that she'll get better very, very soon. She has a lot of work to do next week, too. All right, so do we have anyone who's new to our meetings today? Yes? Oh, wow, we have a few new people. Be sure to get all the answers to your questions today. Be sure, I'll be pointing out some people. We have Janina right here. Be sure to talk to Janina with some questions. She's our adoption counselor. She can answer all kinds of things about tortoises and habitats. So be sure that you get some sort of answers to all your questions and get some contact with Janina or myself before you get out of here today. Are there any folks looking to adopt today? You're saying, you're looking to adopt? Yes? Okay. Well, congratulations on the getting started on that process. We'll be looking forward to talking with you. All right. And we want to also make mention that we should always separate breeding pairs. That's the major problem right now. We have too many tortoises in Las Vegas, too many captive tortoises. So we want to make sure that everyone knows that if you have more than one tortoise out there, if you have a breeding pair, keep them separated. And you can talk to Janina, you can call in the hotline, you can check on our website for some ideas on how to keep those habitats separated. You could still have yours, but you want to make sure that they're not going to breed more tortoises and cause more problems. It's membership renewal time. So if you haven't already renewed your membership for 2015, you can go ahead and do that. We'd love to have you as a member again. And life membership right now is still $500 through the end of this year only. So it's quite the bargain if you're going to live a while. So, life membership, $500 now, $750 if you wait till next year. So $500, quite the bargain. Please get in on that. We'd love to have you as a life member. Help support our organization into the future. These tortoises are going to need us for quite a long time. Some of the tortoises we're homing now will need to be rehomed in the future. It's the nature of an animal that lives as long as the desert tortoise does. So helping to keep sure this organization going to make sure that we have resources to help new custodians make good choices about habitats and desert tortoise health is important. We also have volunteers. We always need volunteers for our meetings, so always feel free to join in the beginnings of the meetings, setting up chairs, at the end of the meetings, tearing down. We'll definitely need refreshments people. We have a few people who have done refreshments today. We want to thank them. We have sign-up sheets. This is the volunteer sign-up sheet. I'll send one over here and one over here. So we're definitely looking for volunteers for setup, for the sales table, and refreshments. So you might have some really great ideas. Maybe you love what our people brought today. It's all terrific food back there. Maybe you're really happy with all of that. Maybe you want to do that too. Maybe you want to do exactly the same thing. Maybe you have some other ideas, you know? So if you got some ideas, please sign up to do some refreshments and share that project with the loyal people who have been helping us out and giving us tasty treats all the time. And planned giving. If you weren't here for the meeting where we discussed planned giving, be sure to check out that opportunity. It's a way to make sure that your tortoise will have a nice future if you weren't there to provide for them any longer. So just like you want to provide for your families, you want to provide for your tortoise and provide for this wonderful organization that helps you figure out what to do with the tortoise. That's kind of nice too. Tuesday is World Turtle Day. I know you're all planning to celebrate that. You probably got that on your calendars already, but World Turtle Day, we can celebrate our Shelly ones, but especially on Tuesday. And Tortoise Group will be at 3-0, I don't know what that word is, 3-0 Elementary School, where students will meet Bird, named after Larry Bird, apparently a basketball player. They're going to learn a little bit about tortoises over there. So that's for World Turtle Day. Anyone planning on celebrating World Turtle Day with their tortoise? Yes? All right. All right. I know I had recently I had a Burrowversary, and Kathy was very creative. She was able to carve my tortoise's name into a cactus pad. So it was an edible invitation, an edible card. So if you have some ideas, what you know what your tortoise likes. Yeah, I know my tortoise would appreciate some roses for World Turtle Day. I'll try to hook him up. So be sure to honor your tortoise in whatever way you feel is necessary on World Turtle Day on Tuesday. And we also have a nice program that will be launching Tuesday on our website. And this is one that we've done in conjunction with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. The Lost, Found, Adopt, Rehome, and Register module will be going live. You say, what's that? Well, Janine is going to tell us what that is.
Hi, everyone. So we're soon going to be having a new portion of our website, and it's going to be right in the front. You're going to see it. It's for people who have, maybe they found a tortoise and they don't know what to do with it. Maybe they lost their tortoise. So this would be important for everyone here. If you find that your tortoise is missing, go to the website, and it says, I lost my tortoise. Go to that. And what you do is you fill out a little form, take one of your pictures, and post it to our website. It's kind of like a Craigslist for lost and found tortoises. And then also, it's a resource for people who have too many tortoises or can't take care of their tortoise anymore. They can post their tortoise online as well. So that'll be new. It's not available today. You're not going to see it today if you go to our website, but look for it next week. And anyone who has a tortoise, definitely look over the I lost portion so that you're familiar with what to do if you ever find your tortoise has escaped, which is really awful and sad. And our goal is to try to reunite pet tortoises to their original home as best as we possibly can. So that is one way that we do it. So, but yeah, take a look about that next week. So that'll be new. And I think executive director, is that next?
Yes. All right. And we have a huge announcement. We have found our new executive director. Yes. And our new executive director is a really neat guy. His name is Ben Ralphs. And Ben Ralphs comes to us from UNLV. He's graduating today with a master's in public administration with an emphasis in nonprofit management. So he's well suited for this job. And you think, oh, well, that's perfect. You know, he knows how to run an organization, but that's not all. His undergraduate degree was in biology, and he's done the tortoise surveying stuff. He actually knows our tortoise. He already has desert tortoise knowledge, and he wants to run nonprofits. And he was the best out of his cohort. They picked him for working with the executive director of the Grantwell program. He, neat guy, lots of energy. He's really interested in data-based decision-making. And what that means for you is, you're probably going to be getting some surveys. Expect that. I can really say that's going to be something that's going to happen from him. He wants to know how you feel about what's happening, what you think should be happening. He wants to make sure that the members are being well represented, and what we need to have happen is what's happening, and everyone's comfortable and happy with how we spend our time here as a tortoise group. So I think that's going to be a real big step forward for us, and we're going to be looking for your input. So don't be surprised if the new guy's asking a lot of questions. That's what we like about him. He's going to make sure that this organization reflects who we are as Nevada people, as desert tortoise interested folks. And so that's pretty exciting. So he can't be here today because it's big graduation day and all, but he's done a lot of tortoise field work, and he starts on May 26th. So that's kind of a nice thing, and I guess you'll meet him next month. He did actually come to a meeting, and he liked it. He stayed awake the whole time. He was totally into it. He had great questions, super input. He was really up for this. And so we wanted to make sure that he was one of our kind of people, and he had a lot of great ideas. So we're really excited about him. We hope you're going to be really excited about him, and you'll meet him next month. Mr. Mies, our video guy, back there, he's brought us some coupons. Harbor Freight is offering this. I call it a burrow thermometer at my house. You probably call it an infrared thermometer everywhere else. Harbor Freight has a deal on these. Thank you. So there's some coupons up here. The coupons say Centec non-contact infrared thermometer with laser targeting, $25.99. And the way they work is you don't point it in the tortoise's eyes. Don't point it in the tortoise's eyes. You don't want lasers in the eyes. Okay? But you can see that little red dot in the wall there? Yeah. So then it's telling me, well, who knows? It's Celsius. I'll give you the number, but it doesn't mean anything to me. 22.6, whatever. All right, so there's that. Do you have, I'm sure it has the other mode as well. I mean, there's no way they just give you Celsius. What'd you do with that? So yeah, so $26 at Harbor Freight, and you got some coupons up here. Be sure to check those out. Sorry, I don't know. Big news on the food program. What we've known as Mega Diet is now Grassland Tortoise Food. It's the same food, but in a better container. No more bags, we have jars. It's a very exciting advancement. Some of you are going, but what about bagging day? Right? Okay, don't panic. There's still something for you to do. We have stickers. We need stickers stuck to every one of these containers. We have stickers for you. So, with that in mind, we have a sticker day. We're calling it the Jar Labeling Fiesta. This is getting serious, people. So, Jar Labeling Fiesta, Thursday, May 21st, 9:30 at Tortoise Group's Storage Unit. That's Storage 1 at Lake Mead in 95, and Kathy can contact you with details. But do we have anybody who's interested right now? Any hands up for the Jar Labeling Fiesta? It's a fiesta, people. All right, name? Sue Brown. Thank you. Okay. Name?
Alita.
Thank you. All right. Do we have anybody else for the Jar Labeling Fiesta? It's a name.
Judy.
Last name?
Anderson.
Anderson. Wow. Oh, how many hands do you have? You got any octopus friends?
There's about 30 cases, and it took me 10 minutes a case to label, but we don't have the same kind of ergonomically great space inside the storage unit, so maybe it'll take 15 minutes per case.
So you're saying 15 minutes per case? You want to, no? All right. Well, we have this up here, so if you want to sign up for the Jar Labeling Fiesta, if you're feeling moved to do that, please go ahead and sign up for that, because we're going to need some help with that. That's a big job, and it makes a big difference, because the other containers, if they don't have that label on it, then it means it's not food that's supporting this organization. And that's the thing that's really important, is that our Mega Diet program was so critical to the success of this organization as a fundraising stream and as a way to make sure that we're getting good nutritional food into the hands of the people who feed their tortoises and people who care. So we wanted to make sure that that's still available. So it's the same great food that we had a whole big talk about the food last year, about how it was low in protein and all the fantastic stuff. It was the right numbers, remember all that? So we didn't want to change food. It's the same fantastic food, just a better container. I think you're going to like it, and maybe a little less messy with the just stickers, you know? All right, so we hope that more of you will want to do some stickers. There we go. Let's see. And the prices. The prices have changed for the food. So for the 15-ounce jar, it is $7 for members, $11 for non-members. So that's cheaper than Mega Diet RF for a bag, but about the same price per pound. And a 60-ounce jumbo jar is $25 for members, $35 for non-members. And so a 60-ounce jar is the same as four jars. So that's like $3 off the fourth jar when you buy them. As a 60-ounce. All right, so Jar Labeling Fiesta. And next meeting is June 20th, and we're going to have John Hyatt from Friends of Nevada Wilderness. He'll be speaking on climate change, global warming, real or imaginary? Oh, I can't wait to find the answer out. So, real or imaginary, natural or man-made, and its effect on tortoises. So we'll be finding that out next month. Do we have any questions that we can answer right now about tortoises? Do you have any questions about tortoise care? Or any tortoise tales to share? Over here? Yeah. Oh, she's going to take. All right, then. Let's see. We're to the May Care Talk. Oh, I didn't even think about it.
That's our agenda.
We're at May Care presentation.
Okay, so we've already covered about half of this stuff here, but this is our agenda for the day. We're going to talk a little bit about caring for your tortoise during the month of May. Things have changed a little bit, and then we're going to have a 15-minute break, and make sure again during the break to come and talk to me, especially you guys over here, and then or Dominique or any of our lovely volunteers in the back there. Maybe they can answer some questions for you. Don't leave without your questions being answered. And then we'll have Jason Jones after the break. So Jason Jones from Nevada Department of Wildlife, he brought Nessie, the Gila monster, and he has a monster of a talk. So I am so extremely excited about this, but and a little movie. So what a fun day. Okay, let's go to the make here. Oh, and there's a cute little picture while we're waiting on that. Yeah, the next PowerPoint presentation. So this weekend got a little cold. And, oh, sure. And my tortoise is just kind of hanging out. She went through a phase where she ate a bunch, but this last week now she's not. She's just hanging out. What are your guys' tortoises doing? Same thing? They're not, they...
Eating just fine.
Yours is just eating just fine, not dealing, okay.
Comes to the back door and sits there. Bangs on it.
Oh, bangs on it. Yeah, I have. Yeah, they get to know where, you know, where the food comes from, where the fridge is, right? Well, not anymore. That's a mega diet. You know, you don't use a fridge unless he doesn't eat it all. So,
I bought a flat of flowers, and Dino thought he was a lawnmower.
Oh, Dino thought he was a lawnmower for a day. Oh, so in one day he ate them all in one day.
I cleaned off one corner. I turned it around.
Oh, okay. Oh, well, great. Yeah, so that is one thing that we try to talk about at every one of our meetings is how our tortoises change throughout the year. They have hormonal levels that change, that fluctuate, and that kind of goes along with the temperature. They kind of how their habits change throughout the year due to temperature. They need to be at a good 80 degrees to digest food properly and to really get their blood going. So I mean, what's the high today? 70? 67? I wish it was like this the whole year, but it won't. So that's what we're going to talk about a little bit, is how our tortoises change. And we're also going to talk about sexing your tortoise, determining if it's a male or female. Does anyone not know if their tortoise is a male or a female? We don't know yet. Oh, you're little. That's right. Yeah. An adult tortoise that they don't know if it's a boy or a girl yet? Or unsure? You guys don't know? Okay, we're going to learn that today. And we have a little flyer over here that summarizes it too, so take that with you as well. And Diane, we don't know if yours are exactly. We're still learning. They're right at that age. They're right at that age, and that's what we're going to talk about here. So May and June, early summer behavior and care. So as we start getting warm, this week was kind of a cold week, but think about as we're starting to get a little bit warmer, your tortoise isn't going to need to sit and bask as much. They're going to be coming out of their burrow and just going and ready to eat. Their bodies aren't cooling down as much at night. And one thing that is for people who have a juvenile tortoise or multiple tortoises, if they come out and they're right at that 7 to 8 inches, they might be becoming mature, male or female. And if they're two males, they'll start fighting. If it's a boy and a girl, they're going to start mating, which is something we need to hopefully stop or not happen at all. Females, adult females might be doing some nesting activity. It is hatchling season right now, so we'll talk about that. And they, of course, enjoy the rain if we have any. I don't know that we will, but we might. So browsing, that's the number one way we suggest a tortoise should eat, and that's on flowers and anything on our plant list. If you don't have a plant list, there's our little care sheet over to the side. Make sure you grab one of those. And that's because if you think about a wild desert tortoise, what does a wild desert tortoise eat? Monocots, there you go. Yeah, whatever they can find, which is flowers and grasses out there, pretty much. And our tortoises, although they are pets, they still, maybe their parents were wild tortoises. They still have all these same instincts, and we want to try to provide that similar idea for them to eat, eating flowers and grasses when they're ready to eat. That's what's important. I mentioned already they have to be at a certain temperature to digest. We don't really know when they're at that temperature, do we? Unless we take one of these laser thermometers, but I don't think that works that way. But so we don't know when they're ready to eat. So we want to provide a good amount of plants. And a variety, too. What a variety of plants does for them is that sometimes tortoises are extremely picky. Does anyone have a picky tortoise? I think everyone should be raising their hand because every tortoise is picky. And that's partially due to a number of factors, but they can smell really well, they can taste really well, and their hormones fluctuate throughout the year. So sometimes their hormones are saying, well, I want to eat glow mallow right now, and then sometimes I'm going to leave the petunias and pansies alone. And then you plant something, you get your hollyhocks started, and they won't touch them, and you start getting mad, and then 3 weeks later, they're completely, you know, decimated. So we want to provide a variety of plants. That's important. And browsing also allows you to go on vacation and not worry so much about your tortoise. You know, you're not hand feeding them every single day when you're on vacation, and they can just come out and eat, and you don't need a tortoise sitter. I mean, I'm sure they're out there. Dominique, do you have a tortoise sitter? The neighbor, the cat nanny, you know. But you don't need it as long as you provide lots of plants. So I want to talk about the grapevine, which is a wonderful plant. We just planted two big ones, and she's gotten a hold of the lower half of them. And I want to mention, with grapevines, do a terrific job here. They grow greatly and easily, but you just want to leave out grapes. So that grapes have sugar, and we've learned from that same talk that Dominique mentioned last year that anything with sugar is not good for a desert tortoise, usually. So here is a terrific idea on how to plant your grapes. This is in March, so not too much growth, but just starting. And it's on a little wire halfway up the wall. Can't really see the wire at all, but that's where the vines connect. And so what this does as it grows, it creates a little shady area under here and a place where Tad can come around and eat everything. And we did something similar. I didn't get a picture, but we put it on a trellis, but a trellis that was only, if this was the ground, the trellis is just a foot and a half up, 18 inches up. So doing something like that, providing shade and food all at the same time. So here's some more plants to have for your tortoise. Trailing primroses, gazanias, Mexican evening primrose is a good one, but a little weedy, but beautiful when it flowers. That's that pink flower that's out right now. Gazanias, looks like he ate all the flowers on that one there. Is that Tad? Yeah, these are all Tad, aren't they? Always. Dandelions. If you can get some dandelions growing in your backyard in a little patch of grass or in some water, very nutritious for the tortoise, and they just love them. And I want to mention, if you are trying to plant dandelion, don't go out and pick dandelion flowers from places that you don't know for sure. They might have herbicides or pesticides on them. But you can collect the actual seeds when then they're in the white tuft ball that kids go and blow on them. You can collect the seeds from parks and schools, and when I walk my dog, I bring an extra doggy bag, and that's where the seeds go. Petunias, there's a little wire mesh cover that only allows the flowers to pop out so that the base of the plant isn't destroyed. So there might be some things that you can figure out how to do. We always talk about the upside down hanging tomato basket too. That's a good one. Globe mallow, it's a native plant here. This is the Mexican evening primrose. Desert willow is a shrub tree that you'd have to, I mean, the flowers fall down, but the tortoise doesn't eat them. You know, you have to go hand pick them, of course, right? Spoiled tortoise. Hollyhocks grow up really tall, and you have to pick the flowers. That was all about browsing, and we always promote, and right now is the best time to start, is a really good time to get going on your yard if you haven't already done so. So sexing the tortoise. So right now your tortoises might be coming out and they might act a little differently. If you've had a couple tortoises and they've gotten along really well, the springtime is when they start coming out. They might have matured over brumation, and a tortoise is mature at around 7 to 8 inches in length. So this is Frida. She's definitely mature, but it's not a time, it's not a year, it's a length. That's when they become mature. Wild desert tortoises at that length are, what, about 15 years old? Depending, 15 or 20, pet desert tortoise could get that long in a matter of a few years, which is kind of scary because they're not supposed to grow that fast. But we feed them too much, or they were fed inappropriately, so they grew really fast. So that's why we want to talk about how to tell the difference between the sexes of your tortoise, a boy or a girl. And let's just go on. And it's not always easy. So that's one thing that we want to say is you want to use all these items that we talk about together. A female tortoise is going to have a flat plastron, which is the bottom part of her shell, whereas a male has a dip, and that's one thing. So let's see what Frida's got. What do you think? I think that's flat. I think that's flat. It's pretty close. There's a little bit of a dip, but really not much. And so that's one thing you want to, why you want to use all these items together. Another item, or another thing that females have, are long back nails, usually. Why do you think that is, though? Dig their nest, exactly. Yep, and we'll talk about that. And males have really big Guler horns. What do you, and that's the Guler horn right in front underneath her chin. What do you think? Is hers really that big? No. And why do males have big Guler horns? To fight and flip each other over. What they do is, if I'm a male tortoise, they go in under here and they flip each other over, and then their counterpart or their opponent doesn't make it in the sun. Another thing is the tails. Females have usually short tails, and males have long tails. Also, one really important thing is the chin glands, and that's something that's happening to your male tortoise right now, is they might be getting big. That's another hormonal surge, is their chin glands might enlarge, and they might actually ooze liquid, and that's completely normal. So don't worry. I did have one picture. Somebody sent me a new adopter. She didn't understand. She didn't know. She sent me a picture, and it even almost looked like a pimple, and then it popped, and it was just fine. So she was really worried. So, and that's with males. Females don't usually have them. As you can see her chin, and come and look at Frida too. Come and look at her. Her chin, she doesn't have them. They're located on each side of your chin here. And don't take it to the vet and say, "Oh my gosh, I'm worried about this," especially a vet that doesn't know tortoises, because they have tried to remove them before in some cases, and it's completely natural and normal. So if you do take your tortoise, please see our tortoise vet list here of people that we know are educated about desert tortoises. So males begin fighting, and they flip each other over, and they might have, they're feeling these hormones that they've never felt before. You know, they're 13 years old now. So they might have gotten along, but now it's a dangerous situation. If they flip over and fight while you're at work and the sun comes along, they're not going to make it. So this is a very dangerous situation, is having tortoises fight. So what are the solutions? Are separation. Maybe you have to build two separate habitats. People have done that before. Or you have to give up for adoption or try to find homes for one of them. And that's exactly what happened to me. I grew up with two tortoises. And I believe, and I was like 6 years old at the time, and I think I had somebody from Tortoise Group actually come over and take one of them. We thought it was a boy and a girl, and we found out quickly it was two males. So egg-laying behavior. So with your female desert tortoises, what you want to look for is your tortoise is kind of pacing around your yard, kind of doing some test digs here and there, and she's trying to figure out where she wants to lay her eggs. Where is the best spot for her eggs to survive? So she might do a couple test holes. She might not be acting normal. Maybe she's not eating. Maybe she's just doing some weird things. And you're like, what is going on with Shelly? And that's something that we need to look for, especially if she's unsterilized. If she's sterilized, maybe we don't know yet if she'll try to lay eggs. I mean, we don't know that yet. If she'd try to dig nests, probably not, but... Yeah, but who knows? It's something to watch out for. One thing is about with females is that you want to be very careful about them flipping over. If they do have this egg-laying nesting behavior, is you never want them to flip over. Otherwise, their eggs could bind on the inside of their system. It's kind of like a sausage. Their internal insides kind of turn and turns into like a sausage, and the eggs are stuck. It's called egg binding. And so you never want to, like if Frida was alive, I'd never flip her over, ever. And the way to look at the underside of a tortoise is to get down. And if she can't seem to lay her eggs, and it might be time to take her to a vet. It might be time for an x-ray to see what's going on in there. So this is a female, and she dug a nice hole in this sandy area. This is her spot. What she does is she digs a hole with her hind legs and long nails, and she covers each egg as she deposits it, and then she might urinate on it, and that's about it. And then she covers it back up, and she leaves, and she's done. And then she's done as a mother. And I've heard people say their tortoise will lay eggs anywhere in the yard. So if you do have a female and you know that she's laying eggs and you're trying to search for them, you have to look everywhere, inside the burrow even as well. Yes, Sue? I don't know. Do you know, Jason? The question, do that? Yeah, the question was how likely are they to lay eggs in the same place, and I'm assuming if it worked once that they would learn and want to try to do it again. That's a great question. Finding them. And then you found a few babies, and that's exactly what happens. Yes, that's one thing. So, That is one thing that females, fertilized females, inseminated females can still lay fertilized eggs for many years after one time that they mate. So that's why it's so important to separate, to learn if you have a boy and a girl first, or what it is, and then separate them, because if they have one opportunity, you are creating a whole bunch of little babies that will need to be taken care of the rest of their life. And as you already know, we have tons of unwanted tortoises every year, and that's a big problem here in Las Vegas. So nesting is right now, May to mid-July, before it gets too hot. A female tortoise can lay 2 to 3 clutches throughout the year. They have another opportunity to lay eggs in the fall when it's cools down. About the same size and shape as a ping pong ball. And females, kind of like chickens, they can lay unfertilized eggs all their life, and that's okay. That's a healthy thing to do, but still could cause some egg binding as well. And then insemination can last for, we've heard, up to 15 years from one time. So if your female tortoise, let's say she does 3 clutches of 10 eggs a year for 10 years, has 300 babies. I can't imagine taking care of 300 animals all by myself anyway. That's a lot. So and that's what happened in Las Vegas, is that, and they're adorable, don't get me wrong. Oh, they're so cute. But they live 80 to 100 years. So you're creating an animal that's going to outlive you, that will outlive you, and that will go to several different homes throughout their lifetime. Who knows how many homes these tortoises that we've dealt with have been in? Hundreds of homes? 10 homes? 2 homes? I don't know. We just don't know. Oh, see, there they are. And incubation's about 90 to 120 days. So you have some time if you're looking for those eggs. And another hatching is late August, early October, when the weather cools down, so the tortoises can walk around and find food before it gets too cold and shelter. So one thing is, they are a temperature-dependent species when they lay their eggs. So if the eggs are on the hotter side, they become females. And if the eggs are on the cooler side, maybe at the bottom of the nest, they're going to be males. So one way I remember this is the term hot mamas. So they're hot mamas. And so that's, I think, is really neat. Is that with all reptiles?
Many, yeah.
Many? Okay. Many turtles and tortoises, or?
Yeah, like crocodiles.
Crocodiles. Oh, neat, yeah. So again, one of our really big messages is to avoid breeding. Find out if you have a boy and a girl. Separate them. Either try to find a home for one if they're not getting along, or before they mate. And one thing is it is actually a Nevada state regulation that you can't accept any more tortoises. So let's say your neighbor comes to you and say, "I found a tortoise. Can you take it?" Legally, you have to say no, but also you don't want to put that stray tortoise in your backyard with your other tortoise because, well, they might mate. That's really, troublesome. But it also could have diseases that your tortoise doesn't have, and they do spread diseases to each other that they can keep forever and potentially make them very sick. And they might fight and flip each other over, and then you're gone at work or not home, and you don't see it, and your beloved Sheldon doesn't make it. So what you do is you tell them, well, you can find them a home. Try to find their original home, of course. Put up flyers. Go to our website, our new website that's going to deal with this exact issue, Lost and Found Tortoises. It'll have all the directions on there. They can post their tortoise online. Post their tortoise on Craigslist if needed, in efforts to find the original home. And to go knock on doors, on neighbors' doors where you found the tortoise. So people, as your friends and family and neighbors know that you have a tortoise or you're talking to them about tortoises, they will find them and come to you and say, I have this tortoise, will you take it? And, there's a lot of cons to taking it. So, and then also, if you do have multiple tortoises, it's becoming where you can sterilize them very easily, soon. A lot of vets already, we have a list of vets over here that do sterilize tortoises, and we had Dr. Gorman talk last meeting about it. I don't know if you weren't here, it's online, and it's a great speech. I learned so much. So the option of sterilizing one or both of your tortoises is becoming available, which is very, very new and neat, and we will be having another sterilization clinic in July that we will need lots of volunteers for. We'll talk about that closer to the date. And one of the best things about learning how your tortoise fluctuates over the year is just watching them. That's one thing that's neat about them is they don't always have the same behaviors. And so us learning about their behavior and why they do things is why we're here, right? That's one reason why I come and I wonder, I'm like, what is he doing? What is she doing? And then I come here and I'm like, oh, that's why. So one thing I do want to mention, though, is it is our first ever free desert tortoise health and microchipping clinic. So you hear about with cats and dogs, right? They have microchipping clinics. Bring your cat. You can get them microchipped for free or low cost. We're doing it for desert tortoises. This is the very first time. This is very exciting. Where anyone who has a tortoise can bring him or her in a high-sided box to be microchipped, health checked, and you can even get a shell tag if you want to. Get lots of tortoise care information, and you can be put on a list for free sterilization at the July sterilization clinic. So we're not able to offer that to every person who comes with a tortoise, but for many people who do come, we're able to offer them free sterilization. So this is really exciting, and it's going to be held May 30th. From 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., come anytime. Just bring your tortoise in a high-sided box or tote and don't leave them in the car. That should be your only errand that you're running right then. We don't know how hot it's going to be, so you don't want, like with any animal, you don't leave them in your car. And so you can register, health check, shell tag, care information, and sterilization sign up all in one day. And we're going to see a lot of tortoises. This is one thing, though. Do you guys have neighbors or friends or people that you know that have tortoises that don't come to tortoise group meetings or that might have multiple that are breeding? Take one of these flyers and say, look, it's free. You're going to learn so much. We're going to have vets there. I'll be there microchipping tortoises, and it's all free. And this is, we're working with Nevada Department of Wildlife and U.S. Fish and Wildlife are supporting it. They're paying for it, for us to put it on. And we do have some terrific volunteers from Tortoise Group that will be there talking about tortoises. If you feel that you want to help out, let me know. I am collecting names for volunteers, but this is really exciting. It is at the Veterans Memorial Leisure Center, 101 Pavilion Center Drive. So Summerlin, I think it's right behind Costco on Pavilion Center. So make sure to take one or a couple of these, and you will be seeing this on our Facebook, on our website, and get the word out. So this is a great opportunity for those friends and family members that might have tortoises that don't know anything about them or that they want to learn, and to sign up to get sterilized so that they don't have babies every year. So any questions on the microchipping clinic? And it's free. Microchips, if you take your tortoise and get it microchipped at a vet, it costs about $65. So, free. Any other questions for now? Oh, great question. Where do they put the microchip? Usually, we like to try to stay in the right-hand side here, the right shoulder. Right about there. Usually, there might be a reason where we might try the left shoulder. And that's because there's kind of a little pocket in between the leg muscle and the neck muscle that, you know, we don't want to shoot it microchip into the neck. There's a little extra skin and extra pocket right there. Yes. Yeah, it's a Home Again microchip, which is a very popular microchip, and they have their Home Again service that if you choose to do so, you can sign up with Home Again. So they're great microchips, and it's going to be a really neat event. So I'd really love to meet some of your tortoises. So bring them. I can put a tortoise to the face, right? Tortoise to the name. Face to the name. Yeah, any other questions? Okay. Well, thank you. I think we are going to take a 15-minute break.
We're going to thank our refreshment people.
Oh, yeah. And thank you. Thank you to Nancy, Diane, and Pauline for providing the refreshments. And Linda is selling little candies over here. It's one of our fundraisers, so get your sweet tooth on, okay? So we'll be back here in about 15 minutes from now. One thing to mention about the microchipping clinic, and that is, I didn't say what size of tortoise that your tortoise needs to be as a micro. You can still bring your tortoise, but for information and for us to look at it and give it a quick health check, of course. But to actually get a microchip, it should be, I don't know, about 5 inches in length. It kind of depends on the microchipper technician, which is myself and another person, what our comfort level is. So, but just estimate maybe about 5 inches is what it half. Yeah, your hand. That's perfect. In order to receive a microchip, we could do the other things though. Just fine.
Think you're saying not smaller, not larger?
No, they can be much larger. that means there's more room in between there where we can shove the microchips, so they definitely can be larger. 5-inch minimum to get a free microchip, so. And I'm just going to have, and so here is the star of the show, is Dr. Jason Jones. And no, not a doctor? Oh, I thought you were. I'm sorry. Okay, we'll get there. But from the Nevada Department of Wildlife, and he's brought Nessie, and I was told that we're not allowed to touch Nessie, correct?
You can touch, probably hold her afterwards.
Okay, all right. She is venomous, so. And his talk, Gila Monster, the story of monsters in our midst, and he will have a little film, Year in a Desert Hole, which has plenty of tortoise cameos, so appearances. So we're going to see a fun video on burrows. So welcome, welcome Jason Jones. I'm going to keep doing that. Dr. Jones, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here. I'm a really loud talker, so hopefully I don't overwhelm you with my voice. So let me know if I'm too much. Does this progress or? Okay, perfect. So kind of my background, just to give you an idea of what I do, I am the herpetologist, the reptile biologist specifically for Nevada Department of Wildlife. I'm an in-the-closet amphibian ecologist. That's what I did my graduate work on. Ironically enough, decades ago, I really wanted to pursue work with desert tortoise. And I think when I was a kid, about the time that the tortoise group started, I remember seeing some of the booklets from the tortoise group and really wanting to have a tortoise. I lived in Utah, so I couldn't have one. I guess I could have adopted, but didn't know this. But interestingly, my kind of career and academic choices have, I think, made me more of a well-rounded herpetologist than not. I spent time working for a professor who was doing a lot of turtle work, mostly in Australia and South America, and it was kind of funny because I really wanted to pursue turtle and tortoise work, and he at the time had stopped and decided to do more lizard work. So I found myself working on a lot of lizards, which was really cool. And then my master's degree, I worked with a rattlesnake ecologist, and I was the only at the time, amphibian graduate student he had. So I was working with frogs. So I have constantly been paired with people that aren't quite doing what I'm doing, but for the most part understand what I'm kind of doing. So it's just kind of a natural progression, I guess, that, you know, just some kind of a jack of all trades, master of none. But I've always wanted to start out this talk with this slide. I think this is appropriate in a sense. This is from the 50s. All those like cult, like horror film movies about crazy critters, you know, everything from birds, right, to like there's like a frog video that's really great if you haven't seen that. But this right here, maybe, I just hit the, I'll just be able to click it.
Virtually unexplored regions, bleak and desolate.
Can you guys hear this?
Where no human ever goes and no life is ever seen. It is as though the land had been poked by God. It is in these lonely areas of impenetrable forest and dark shadows that the Gila monster still lives.
They're saying that this is the Gila monster habitat, right? Is this the lobby?
No man.
But it's really hospitable. Godforsaken place. Kids hanging out, ready to make out. Classic horror story. Get. So that's the kind of like things you deal with when you're a herpetologist.
Just move it back.
There we go. Hopefully I don't deafen you before the end of this. Is this okay? So that wasn't really my talk, but I do want to start off my talk with just thanking a lot of people, and I'm sure you're recognizing some of these names. Some of these folks have been around doing tortoise work or even Gila monster work for a long time. But it takes a lot of people to do seemingly small projects. And that's because, you know, if you're not a master of something, you need to find those people who are, and they usually take you under their wing and guide you. So thank you to a lot of people. So a lot of what I'm going to talk about is based on what other people have done, kind of standing on the shoulders of giants. And also a huge thanks to the Gila monster. What we do to figure out where they're going and their behavior requires that we catch some, we knock them out, we implant radios, we do all sorts of stuff, and it's not the preferred thing to do with a critter, but sometimes it's the only way to get information about such a secretive and hard to find species. So again, I just want to always say thanks to the Gila monster for letting us study them. You know, I guess they're not really letting us, but you know. So here's my outline of my talk. I'll give you a background on what is in a name. Talk a little bit about evolution. Little background on some of the studies that I'll be referring to. Get into envenomation, because they are a venomous reptile. Talk a little about their ecology, behavioral ecology. A little bit about conservation, citizen science, and how that ties in, like what people can do. People especially live in the Vegas area, what you guys can do for Gila monsters. And then I'll end it with some questions. And there are some embedded videos in here, so hopefully you guys, if you haven't seen a Gila monster, we'll see one today. Have any of you guys ever seen a wild Gila monster? Just raise your hands. That's pretty awesome. That's certainly the most hands I've seen in an audience. Was it around the Vegas area? That's really hard. So Arizona, it's easier, not to discredit that, but that's amazing. So Nevada is really hard. It's almost like finding, maybe not like a unicorn, but California, it's definitely like going and finding a unicorn. So has anyone ever found one in California? There you go. It's kind of a unicorn. That's what I'm referring to. So I'll start off with these two, what's in a name, and then talk a little bit about evolution. Which I know right now, I think I'm competing with a paleontologist, Jack Horner, who's giving a talk today, right, on paleontology and dinosaurs. So this is going to be a hack of that. So Heloderma, that's their genus. The Helodermas consist of essentially two species. One is the beaded lizard, which is known mostly in Central America, exclusively in Central America. And the other one is the Gila monster. And it's pronounced Gila as in the Gila River. So presumably it was first discovered or observed in vicinity of the Gila River. Thus, it's given its name. Other people suspected that Heloderma, maybe people just kind of chopped the name up and pronounced the G with the H, who knows. But presumably it's because of the Gila River, and that's exactly what we see right here, is the Gila River in the backdrop, and the Gila monster walking across the rock. The reason they're called Heloderma, Heloderma means nail-studded skin. And so they're obviously not nails that are in the skin, but rather bone fragments. So it's actually like an osteoderm. It's an actual bone fragmented skin. So they're literally walking around the landscape with armor on. That's why these guys are called beaded lizards, because they too have beads throughout their skin, bone fragments, that protect them. Gila monster skin is really, really, really hard to actually poke. So you can imagine that's really good if you're walking through Choya, or you're trying to avoid being eaten by a bird or something like that. So the beaded lizard's name is Heloderma horridum, the horrible one. That's what that means. Probably because they're pretty big and they hiss and they have a kind of an ornery disposition, rightfully so, because they are venomous. And then the Gila monster that we have here in Nevada, its scientific name is Heloderma suspectum. So it was suspected to be venomous, and indeed it is. So I think these two figures right here kind of give a great depiction of the distribution and the change in terms of morphology of the two species. So right up here, these two, that's the Gila monster. This right here, these are beaded lizards. Tell Hicks is a great artist. He painted all of these. And this just lines up perfectly with the distribution of these species and their subspecies. So right here we have Heloderma suspectum cinctum, the banded Gila monster. You'll notice that here's Nevada, a little bit into Utah around St. George area, and just poking into some of the smaller mountain ranges in California. And then you have the reticulated Gila monster, Heloderma suspectum, that occurs primarily in the Sonoran Desert and goes into Mexico. And then from here down, you have beaded lizards, and these all line up with the different subspecies. So Charles Bogardi landing way down there. So you can see the range of the Gila monster is pretty wide, and beaded lizard is pretty extensive as well. So 80 million years ago, this is probably the scene on the landscape. The cousin of the Gila monster was probably wreaking havoc on dinosaur eggs. It's pretty remarkable that it's been 80 million years that these guys have been around, and very little has changed. And to kind of put you in some sort of time perspective, I think Lois Leakey probably had the best analogy, and that's a toilet paper roll, which is about 400 sheets of paper, equals the Earth's history. So if you will, just kind of think about this in an abstract term. But if you go all the way to the very end of this toilet paper roll, about 19 rolls in, we have dinosaurs and early mammal-like forms coming onto the landscape. That was a long time ago, right? And you get to fourth roll in, and that's when dinosaurs went extinct. This little asterisk indicates where Gila monsters, or their cousins rather, emerged, evolved. And so you could say that maybe Gila monsters caused the decline of dinosaurs, but I'm not going to say that. I just think that's kind of cool coincidence. And then the very last, this little like millimeter on the very end of this roll, this last paper, is where hominoids come onto the scene. So Gila monsters have been around for a lot longer than humans. And what's really interesting, at least for me, is that some of the earliest forms in this family of Gila monsters date back, like I said, anywhere from 80 to 65 million years ago. They look just like this. So this is a fossilized skeleton. And if you note, it's surprisingly similar to what a Gila monster's skeleton and skull looks like. And notice that the Gila monster's skull is actually beaded. So it's not like the bone fragments in the skin are on there, it's actually beaded. So that's kind of a cool look. And it you know, really hasn't changed much. That just really blows me away. And size-wise, hasn't changed terribly much as well. So whatever they're doing is working. And so to give you kind of an idea evolutionarily where these guys sit in the tree of kind of lizards, here are iguanas, like desert iguanas, chuckwallas, things of that nature. You have skinks. I don't know if anyone's here seen like Western skinks or Great Basin skink or even, there's a variety of different skink species that we even have in Nevada. You also have geckos, so like the little banded gecko that we have in our desert. Then you have alligator lizards. So these guys are all relatively distinct. And then you have the monster clade. All of these guys are extinct minus the Gila monster and the beta lizard. And then you have this group right here, which is actually a more arboreal tree-dwelling monitor lizard. And then you have varnids, which are monitors, like Komodo dragons. So the Gila monster is actually more closely related to things like Komodo dragons and alligator lizards than anything else on Earth. But they're obviously kind of on their own now. So they're very unique species, and they are the only two venomous. Although what's interesting is if you look more and more that we look at like the enzymes and whatnot the Komodo dragons are producing, it seems to mimic some sort of venom. So things change when we look into it. So a little background. Obviously Native Americans and folks inhabiting some of the Central American and Southwestern deserts probably came across Gila monsters and beta lizards far before European settlers. But the first written documentation that we have of Gila monsters or beta lizards comes from 1577 from Hernandez. And that's a pretty long time to know about something, you know, when you think about it. Fast forward 300 years later, and the first description emerges of a Gila monster in written text. So pretty amazing that they kind of went 300 years without at least the European settler describing them. Fast forward to 1956, so another 100 years, and the first actual like publication comes out really describing what we know about Gila monsters and their allies, which essentially are beaded lizards. So these two right here, Charles Bogart and Rafael Martin del Campo, were kind of the first people to really start looking at Gila monsters and investigating kind of the nuances of their ecology and behavior. They're a really secretive critter, you know, so it's kind of a lot of mystique surrounding them. One little plug, since I did say I was an in-the-closet amphibian ecologist, if you guys have ever had a chance to listen to like the really kind of classic amphibian calls, at least the older ones were actually narrated by Charles Bogart. So you can be a Gila monster ecologist and an amphibian ecologist, apparently. So this slide is really just meant to kind of bring your attention to like where we are graphically before I go into more details about some of the giants like Bogart and Del Campo that I'll be standing on the shoulders of. Because like I said before, you know, a lot of this work requires that you literally stand on the shoulders of some of these giants, because it's really hard when you only have like five Gila monsters to say a lot about a population or something that's so wide ranging. But these stars right here, the red ones, are kind of some of the studies that I'll summarize and synthesize, if you will. These yellow ones are more of the Sonoran subspecies, the reticulated monster. And so that's kind of just bringing your attention to the geography of some of the places I'll be talking about. So one of the biggest giants, I think, in the field currently is Dan Beck. He's done some amazing work. Specifically, he's done a lot of work with banded Gila monsters in the St. George area. And so I'm definitely going to be using a lot of what he has kind of synthesized in this great book. If you want a cool book to read, this is it. Also, Chris Ganger, who I don't know if you guys are familiar with Dick Tracy. He's a professor at UN Reno. And Chris did some great work out of Valley of Fire about 12, 15 years ago. And so some of the stuff I'll be talking about obviously comes from some of his work, the Valley of Fire, since it's so close. And then, of course, I'll be talking about some of the work that we currently are doing here in the Vegas area. And so kind of a hot topic is envenomation. You know, they are the lone lizard species in the contiguous U.S. that produces venom, and it's a pretty interesting thing. And here's some cool cartoons just illustrating the skull of a Gila monster, kind of venom glands, and just the head of a Gila monster. They're pretty tough looking critters, kind of like the pit bull of lizards. Now, to kind of compare and contrast rattlesnakes versus Gila monsters, when you think of a rattlesnake, you think of like those top fangs, and they're more like a hypodermic needle. And so when they actually envenomate, they'll puncture, and they have amazing control, amazing muscle control to actually envenomate their prey. So a rattlesnake can essentially choose what needle, what tooth to shoot venom out of. So they have really, really good control. So contrary to popular belief that like small rattlesnakes are more deadly because they can't control their venom, that's not true. But they're really good at controlling that venom because they do have these glands and they do have muscles that control those glands because it comes through teeth. So it literally comes through this needle and exits out the base of the tooth. In contrast, Gila monsters have these grooves where venom exits. And sometimes they'll have these teeth that are kind of, they have this nice little edge that facilitate kind of venom to run through up into their teeth. But for the most part, what they're doing is they're actually creating venom in their chin gland right here. So I was just thinking about tortoise chin glands and them exuding. Good thing they're not venomous, right? These guys are actually exuding venom into their saliva. So their venom's mixing with their saliva. So when they bite, they're able to essentially facilitate like that injection of venom into their prey. So you would imagine that unlike a rattlesnake whose preference is to hit a prey item and then coil back and wait for it to stumble off and die, these guys actually will bite and hold on for dear life because their ploy is to essentially immobilize the animal and like give it kind of like a mild heart attack, if you will. So they're not deadly for humans. There was some little anecdote I read that stated, I think it was like in the late 1800s, someone purportedly died from a Gila monster bite, but had also drinking like a gallon of vodka or something, you know, something that was like, and it was a Gila monster that killed him. But so it's unlikely. It's never, by all accounts, it's never happened. That said, if you're bitten by a Gila monster, it hurts really bad, and it could hurt for a week or so. So don't get bit by a monster. But it's really hard to get bitten by a monster. You really have to kind of like molest them, bother them a lot. In the rattlesnake lab I worked in, we used to say there's three T's to being bitten by a rattlesnake, or in this case, a Gila monster. You have to be in your 20s and 30s. You have to be drinking tequila. And you have to have testosterone. So if you're a woman who doesn't drink and is younger or older than 20 or 30, you're in the clear. You're never going to be bitten. And, you know, that said, like, sometimes people accidentally sit on things or whatever, but for the most part, it's people harassing wildlife that get envenomated by venomous critters. So one cool thing about venom is that for rattlesnakes, you know, or other venomous snakes, we've actually used venom to help with things like blood clotting. People use synthesis, they synthesize venom in labs, and they'll use that to help with blood clotting. The sodium potassium pump that's known to produce ATP, that was first found thanks to venom. So venom is really specific, and it usually targets certain cell receptors. Because of that, we're able to kind of use it in medical applications. And one thing that's really interesting about Gila monsters is that the St. George population, they took venom from one of those critters, and they were able to isolate what they refer to as exudin 4. And this is a peptide that's found in venom. And venoms work to essentially cleave off molecules and adhere to receptors. and whatnot. And what they found was in 1992 that this actually helped with type 2 diabetes. Now, if you think about this, Gila Monsters may eat, I don't know, 2 or 3 meals, maybe more a year, but they're eating a lot. They'll eat like an entire rat family, you know, and they'll clear out nests of tortoises, things like that. And so they're eating a lot, and then they go and they hunker down for a month or two. So, you know, how crazy would that be for your blood sugar, right? I mean, it would be insane. You would be constantly trying to regulate that. So somehow they're able to regulate this. So it's no wonder that they're essentially providing the cure for type 2 diabetes through their venom. Pretty interesting stuff. Also, what's kind of interesting is that this year, I believe in October, in Baltimore, another group has been looking at how exudin 4 is actually helping with Alzheimer's in mice. So it's a potential cure for Alzheimer's. So you never know if that crazy thing that's venomous is going to kill you or save your life. It's kind of the take-home point. But another thing that's like really startling to me is that exudin 4 was recently sold from Amylin to Eli Lilly and Company for $325 million. So obviously, it's working. Okay, now back to the monster. So again, just to kind of refocus you on this area, just remember they kind of occur like this, and then you got the other subspecies over there. Gila monsters, I like the tortoise sexual dimorphism, looking at females and males and trying to figure out what it is visually that distinguishes the two. So monsters are really hard to distinguish, male from female. And it gets easier with more monsters that you see. But my guess is, has anybody here seen 2 in the wild? There you go. So it'd be really hard to compare your 1 to nothing, right? And guess. At least you got a 50-50 chance, I guess. But what's interesting is that as monsters get bigger, this is a snout vent length. So they're from the tip of their snout all the way to their cloaca, to the base of their tail. This is that length. And as they get bigger, their head width increases if you're a male. So if you're a male, you have a bigger head. I don't know if it's because of ego or mostly it's because they're actually wrestling. And I'll show you a video of monsters wrestling, and it's really cool. But they do this head press trick where they're actually trying to force the other monster to like submit in a sense. So it's really important then for males to kind of have big heads for Gila monsters. Maybe not so much for humans, I don't know. And then females, like I said, a little smaller head. I also wanted to just show like they have huge paws for their size. And that's obviously for digging. They spend a lot of the time underground. So kind of like gophers, kind of like desert tortoises. You know, they're built for digging and excavating holes. And they do a really good job of it. We've only found one little monster in all of our studies. Gila monsters are really hard to find. They're kind of like the lost years for a sea turtle. You know, it's something that it's just really hard to find them. But I did want to show you a cute photo of some baby Gila monsters because they're just so cute. Another thing, timing-wise, Janina brought up some good stuff about how like it's the season for tortoises to start breeding, courting, fighting, etc. Similarly, you know, we're right here. It's like prime time season for male-male combat. So male monsters will definitely fight for females. Mating, obviously. That's why they're doing it exactly the same time. Spermogenesis, so males producing more sperm, overlaps right then. Enlarged follicles for females, so it's all overlapping in this time frame. What I really think is interesting is once female monsters lay eggs, let's say end of August, it's not until almost May when we first start seeing baby Gila monsters. So really, like, nothing is known about how this goes down, whether monsters are hatching in a hole and waiting until it's perfect time in spring to come out, or whether it takes them actually that long. In captive propagation places, there's only one that I know of that's in Colorado. Doc Seward has been able to successfully breed Gila monsters, and it turns out it almost takes a half a year for them to incubate. That's a long time, right? It's a really long time. So that's probably why we don't really know much about Gila monsters. And similarly, my guess is females probably store sperm, just like tortoises. So you can only imagine, like, you never know. You never know when you're going to bump into a little baby or juvenile Gila monster. It's just such a hard thing to guess. One thing that's interesting that we're trying to study, that kind of everybody who's done Gila monster work tends to do, is figure out like a home range. How big of an area does a Gila monster need to roam? And you can imagine living in the desert, like with the desert tortoise, you're really limited on, in many cases, food, water, and shelter, right? Those are the three things that are probably definitely driving your decisions on a day-to-day basis. And so Gila monsters, this is small print, but has home range, and you can just see there's a lot of studies that estimate home ranges, estimate number of shelters used, and these guys in some cases can use over 50 shelters. Here's one right here in Arizona using 124 shelters, male. And in many cases, females tend to have smaller home ranges, which makes sense because they're more concerned about finding good places to deposit eggs, whereas males are roaming far and wide to find females. And so presumably that's why you see like increased home range sizes, because males are looking for girls. And this is kind of a cool depiction of that. Let's just pretend this could be a female monster right here, and this is like a male monster. Obviously, there's a lot of overlap with home ranges. So that kind of makes sense. You know, there's probably hot spots because of shelter, food, and water where lots of Gila monsters are congregating. Similar to rattlesnakes, they seem to need this juxtaposition of like cliff, rocky terrain, and washes. So you can imagine, you know, there's probably lots of mammals that are frequenting some of those washes, and then you got shelters with those boulders and the rocky outcroppings, and then when it does rain, it all kind of pools in the desert, you know? So it's probably a good thing to associate with that kind of habitat feature. And actually, let me... Here you go. Whoops. The top right one, this guy, if you can just click on that. So for those of you who have never seen a Gila monster in the wild, this was taken by a volunteer of mine. She was tracking one of our Gila monsters, and he just came lumbering past her. He's like, do-do-do. And it's really interesting. If you don't make a lot of noise and you stand pretty still, they're not really intimidated by you. They'll just kind of stroll right up to you. And she was kind of like, should I move or should I let him walk on my shoe? I don't know. And she just stood there like, this is awkward. This right here is a little transmitter. We made a little backpack early on, which is a bad idea because they wrestle and they crawl in really teeny holes. So eventually they'll pop the backpacks off. So we surgically implant them. That's kind of the standard. And I can talk a little more about that. So to go back, shelters are important, right, in terms of your home range. Also food and water, right? So 80 million years ago, they're probably eating a bunch of triceratops babies in eggs. And today, they're eating quail, desert tortoise, lots of lizards, snake eggs, small mammals, cottontails. And this is all pretty small print, but this says juvenile mammals. So you can see there's a lot of studies. There's one, two, three in this one, two in that one, one. So a lot of studies have been done just looking at museum specimens that have Gila monsters and picking through those specimens and seeing what's inside of their stomachs. And it turns out they eat everything from cottontail rabbits, squirrels, all the way to rats, pack rats. They eat gambles, quail, doves, thrashers, desert tortoise eggs. The problem with like a lot of what we call squamate or lizard and snake eggs, they all kind of look the same. So it's really hard to discern what species they're eating when you just see an egg. So these are eggs right here of a monster that actually we found at Valley Fire that was hit by a car. So you know, those things, sad as it may be, go to museums, and that kind of enlightens us in a way in terms of what they're doing, what they're eating, things like that. But they go all the way from lizard eggs. Just see, there's a lot of stuff that we find in their stomachs. But it's primarily these three things. So I like to think of Gila monsters as kind of aptly named, in the sense that if you were a baby quail, if you know you're a little baby quail and your mom reads you books or whatever, and you're worried about the monster under your bed, it's real. It's real if you're a quail or a squirrel or a desert tortoise egg. You know, it's literally the monster under your bed that will crawl in and eat you. So they're not seeking things like rattlesnakes, where they're going out on the landscape and trying to take down big meal items. They're really targeting kind of the more feeble, the easier targets. But that's not an easy task. I mean, how many of you have seen snake or lizard eggs out in the desert? You know, that's like not an easy task. So these Gila monsters with forked tongues are able to actually find some of these nests, dig them out while probably a mama's screaming at them, and eat the eggs. And in many cases, you know, if you're venomous, probably a lot of these critters quickly learn that don't mess with the Gila monster eating your eggs, because next year you can have eggs. But if you mess with them, they may in fact eat you. If you wouldn't mind clicking this, this is really cool. This was another one of our monsters that was just like excavating, presumably for eggs of, I'm guessing, a lizard. But you can just see it's kind of like tripod back legs, huge feet, right? Super dirty. And it's just like in the middle of a wash. And this Gila monster could care less that she was right there filming. She'll come out and just sit there and dig, tongue flick, takes a little rest. Yeah, and just look at that, like the dirt it's able to move. Pretty efficient digger. This monster has definitely done this before. Yeah. I mean, it's amazing. It's one of those things where you're just literally like a student of the Gila monster. Probably total length. About that big. Almost 15 inches. 16 inches. You can hit the space bar just for the sake of time. Awesome. So another one of my volunteers was out tracking a male monster that is known to roam far and wide, and came upon a very mad female desert tortoise. And you could see the monster's tail, and it's jammed into this crack. And on the apron, literally right here, the apron of this burrow were a ton of tortoise eggs. So this monster was obviously searching far and wide for something to eat. And so that's kind of a common thing, you know. And you think about the decline of tortoises and how tortoises are threatened. You have to wonder what's the status of a top carnivore on that landscape that really is tied to burrows and eggs and all these things for millions of years has been tied to the landscape with tortoises. You know, you got to wonder what's the status of a Gila monster, you know. As sometimes sad as I am to see like tortoise eggs being eaten, you know, it's like we never even see baby Gila monsters. And that's probably just because they're hard to find. But nevertheless, kind of something to make you go, hmm. So I will warn you, this is a little graphic. If you don't want to see a bunny being eaten by a Gila monster in the wild, don't watch. But if you do, this is a pretty cool video. I can tell you if it's over if you're not going to watch. Come get you. Yeah. So I know Cameron really well, and he was, I jokingly told him that he totally put a bunny out and had a monster in his backyard or something to get this film. But he literally came across a Gila monster that had just grabbed a small cottontail bunny, and he said it startled, and the Gila monster actually released the bunny, and the bunny was kind of like a little shooken up. And then he just backed off, and that Gila monster went right after it again. He was obviously really hungry. But what I really want to point out is that that's a really big bunny in comparison to the Gila monster. And the fact that that thing is going to eat it is just, it's just amazing. Isn't that wild? Yeah, it's totally like a snake eating a rat. So very adapted for consuming large quantities of food and then hunkering down for a month or so, you know? No, I mean, it's just really flexible. Yeah, they're just extremely flexible. Yep. What's that? Yeah. There you go, it's over. It's fast. Yep, it's over. Okay.
Yeah,
now he's coming out for the cameraman, tipping the cameraman's car over and eating him and his girlfriend. So, kind of the question is, well, what eats Gila monsters? Obviously, you know, like they're eating seemingly anything they want, as long as it's small. But roadrunners, I'm sure, eat their fair share of baby Gila monsters in particular. This is cool because it's a king snake that had just consumed Gila monster. I just actually found a speckled rattlesnake that regurgitated, and it looks like it has the tail of a Gila monster inside of its, it was eating. Hawks certainly eat Gila monsters. Probably anything that really is hungry, like a coyote, things like that. If they're willing to give it a try, you know, there's definitely a cost associated with trying to eat a venomous reptile, but you know, I'm sure it happens for a lot of different things. So the other thing that I mentioned was water. Water obviously is nothing trivial here in the desert. And really quickly, so this right here is kind of like a list of total evaporative water loss. So it's like sweating, essentially. It's like how you lose water, right? We all lose water to thermoregulate, to get cooler. Like you go outside, you start sweating when it's hot. Similarly, reptiles, if they overheat, have to do some sort of evaporative water loss. And it's usually through their cloaca. And so this right here is a collared lizard. Something that you commonly see out like at Red Rock. Desert iguana, which you see like in Ivanpah, El Dorado Valley, is probably here in the Vegas Valley. These were extremely abundant at one point. Chuck Wallace. Bearded dragon. For those of you who know the pet trade, bearded dragons are extremely popular. Shingleback skink, also from Australia. And the Gila monster. And one thing I want to note, like this goes from kind of smallest lizard to biggest lizard. And interestingly, these guys are considered, this one right here is mostly an insectivore. So it eats mostly big insects. These two right here are herbivores. So they're kind of like a desert tortoise. They're only eating like forbs and grasses and fun things like that. Bearded dragon's an omnivore, so it'll eat a little bit of everything. Same with the shingleback skink. Gila monster's a carnivore, right? I don't know if that's really any indication, but just kind of interesting life history stuff going on there. This right here is Celsius, so this is over 100 degrees. So it's tipping out like what something would really like to be in. A lot of species, once they get out past 40 degrees Celsius, it's like they need to find shelter. And if they stay in hot sun and it's 40 plus C, they're probably going to die. You'll see that the collared lizard doesn't lose that much. Desert iguanas lose a little much. They really like hanging out there, but they're also an herbivore, so they're eating a lot of juicy forbs and things like that. So they're probably getting a little more water than other things. Chuckwalla, pretty low as well. Bearded dragon, getting up there a little bit. Gila monster, off the charts. So Gila monsters actually have what we call leaky skin. So they're able to evaporate lots of water, lose lots of water to avoid overheating. And being so big-bodied, they need a lot of heat initially to kind of get moving, right? Like a desert tortoise. You probably see your tortoises come out, bask, hang out, warm up, and then they got all this momentum and they can truck around all day. Especially if it's an overcast day, they can seemingly go for a while. Gila monsters similarly can go for a while. They can move for maybe a mile in a single movement, but if it's too hot, it comes at a huge cost. That's not a good adaptation to have in the desert, especially like the Mojave Desert, where monsoonal rains are probably not frequent. Water is a commodity. And so that's kind of a big question right now is like what with climate change and changes in monsoons and things like that, Lake Mead dropping, it's a good indication that we're getting less water. What's the plight of the Gila monster like in the next few years or decades? Good question. But one thing we do know is that they definitely will drink. And if you wouldn't mind clicking on this up here, you'll see a Gila monster drinking. It's pretty cool. They're kind of like a little, like a equivalent of a lizard dog. Maybe, here, let me do that. Try that one. So that's the standing water. That's what's really cool. When it does rain and it's warm enough, if you go out hiking, some of the surrounding mountain ranges of the Vegas area, you could in fact come across this very scene where a Gila monster is drinking out of a temporary pool of water. And they kind of do this thing where they kind of like seem to drink and then kind of like stretch out a little bit. But this Gila monster, I believe, drank for like 30 minutes, 45 minutes. And you're going to see the whole thing. No, I'm just kidding. So temperature is something that they have to deal with, right? And similar to a desert tortoise, shelters are really important. And that's because shelters provide them with not only like a refuge from that heat, some sort of like thermal barrier, right? In cold days, it's relatively warm in a burrow. Hot days, it's relatively cool. But they also provide them with some sort of humidity too, which is really important. And this is kind of cool. So when we do put transmitters inside of Gila monsters, in the last decade or so, with all the technological advancements we've had, we're able to put these little tiny, I have a couple transmitters up here as well, but we're able to put these little teeny things in that are like the size of a Smartie inside of a Gila monster. And this actually measures temperature. And we set it to measure temperature for every 45 minutes. And what that does is it gives us an indication as to when Gila monsters are coming out of burrows, when they're active, and kind of what they're doing. And that's something that is really hard to guess when something stays underground for what most people say 90% of their life. But you can imagine, obviously, there's a time in the spring when you're probably not spending 90% of your days underground. You're looking for food and mates. And so this is really cool because that these little eye buttons that we put inside of them give us that. So this is a shelter temperature, this dotted line. The blue line's air temperature, right? So you'd expect as it goes from 4 a.m. to 8 p.m., temperature gets hot, midday, starts to go down after the sun's setting. This right here is substrate temperature. If anyone here has walked out on the road on a hot day and put your hand on the road, it's super hot. Or try to walk out barefoot, it's way hotter than the ambient temperature. And so what's really interesting is you can see that Gila monster is probably hanging out in the shelter, comes out, totally tracks, like literally follows that line of the substrate. It's probably laying on a rock, follows that line up. This right here indicates that it probably went back into a shelter. So kind of decreases temperature a little bit and then went back out. And then kind of kept going in and out of shelters, went into a shelter for a little while, went back out, and then hung out in a shelter. So that's what's really cool. And we put these eye buttons inside of them. Sometimes we also put little trail cameras in front of their dens. And you see that kind of behavior, that they'll come out, they'll bask, they'll go back in, and they kind of fidget and keep coming in and out. And so they're behaviorally thermoregulating, and that's kind of a really cool thing. It's something that we wouldn't catch otherwise, and so we start to get an understanding of when the best time is to go find Gila monsters given the season, and that's our hope. But also you can imagine that when we start to look at some of this stuff, it's kind of like a thermal signature, and that might be important for climate change. So speaker next month is going to talk about that. But one thing to think about, it's like if you're able to see what monsters are doing now, you can potentially predict what will happen given we can kind of model climate change scenarios. So we could kind of see how that might affect Gila monsters in the future. So it's a guess. And all models are wrong. Some are useful. And in this case, this might be some sort of useful thing that we can do to predict how well Gila monsters will do in some habitats. So that's our hope. And this right here just kind of shows, again, all these bouncy lines right here. Day, night, day, night, day, night, day, night, day. And this right here, Gila monster, pretty much hanging out. Oh, it came out. Came out again. Actually, it was hanging out at night in July. Came back out in the middle of the day or the evening of the day. Then went back in. So you can see that all of a sudden you start to pick up on activity periods, which is just kind of a cool little thing. And that's, I don't know if you can see that Gila monster, but that's like kind of sometimes a classic like daytime burrow or shelter. And so this is actually a monster that we're monitoring. This is a camera trap that's set up. I was telling you that we try to get activity just to see when they're coming out, when they're going. Also, if other monsters are visiting them that we've never seen before. And you can imagine, so this right here is reused shelters. and this is the number of those reuse shelters, and it goes from January to December, and you can see that most individuals overwinter by themselves. You know, they've got their little nook, and they don't want to be social, they go hang out, they pass out all winter, and then come peak breeding season, all of a sudden you have a lot of reuse shelters that are very social. So there's a lot of Gila monsters reusing shelters, same shelters. Why do you think that is? They're looking for love, huh? They are. Yeah, and that's exactly what this says, when you're being social. So these monsters are being separate, they're not hanging out, and these monsters are actually concurrently using the same shelter. So it's like four monsters in one shelter. That's the maximum number of Gila monsters you've ever seen in a shelter, and it only happened for like a few days, and then they all dispersed, presumably because the males were wrestling, loser got kicked out, he went on a long shame walk, and you know, the winner followed the female around. But that's kind of stuff that, you know, it's really hard to find out some of this information unless you have a transmitter inside of them and you're camera trapping and doing all this other fun stuff. So now on to the wrestling. So these guys kind of do this Greco-style Roman wrestling. It's really cool. Have any of you seen like rattlesnakes wrestle before or do combat? Or they intertwine, kind of similar. You know, these guys are, their tails are essentially prehensile tail. So unlike iguanas, where they can lose a tail and regenerate, Gila monsters don't do that. And it's a fat reserve. And they can, I mean, you could almost have a Gila monster hang from your finger with its tail. So they're really, I think, used for a lot of combat rituals as well. And so if you could actually hit this, there you go. So this is in the Red Cliffs Reserve in Utah. I think this video, I wasn't able to put the video of one of our two males wrestling, but this just gives you an idea of how the wrestling match kind of starts. So there's a female back here, and it's really cliche. When you see two monsters wrestling, without a doubt, somewhere in the very close proximity, a female is waiting for the winner. And they move fast. They're very deliberate. And see those that head? He's doing head pressing right there. And the tops of their heads can get really raw and kind of bloody from this activity. Wrestling matches can last for hours, if not like 12 hours. I think that's the record I've heard of. They take siestas kind of between, but it's pretty intense. Can you imagine like wrestling somebody for like 12 hours and taking breaks? I mean, that's like way better than Mayweather and Pacquiao. And they'll bite each other. So sometimes you have like bleeding arms. It's pretty aggressive. They don't, unlike tortoises, which can flip each other and potentially kill the other male in that regard, it doesn't seem like Gila monsters are actually out there to kill the other monster, but they're definitely wearing the other monster out. And I was really lucky. Last week I actually ran into one of our monsters that I think had lost a battle, but it was interesting to kind of follow him around because he was pretty tired. But see that head pressing, I mean, it's just like continuous and they're very persistent. And those tails, you know, it's like intertwined. And initially, I think when people observed this, they thought it was mating. But to my knowledge, I don't think anyone's observed mating in the wild. I could be wrong, but it's presumed that it happens inside of a den. So obviously, you'd be at an advantage if you were a bigger monster, because if you remember from that graph I showed you, the bigger you are, the bigger your head. Therefore, you probably have an advantage not only physically to get on top of the other monster, but also when you're head pressing, it's way higher surface area, and you're able to really take that other monster out. I mean, that guy's like, I'm out of here. This dude's like, no way, and bites him. And then does this like weird, funny roll. Ugh. Awkward. All right, so On to like a little bit about conservation, citizen science, and then I'll end this. So in 1996, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service removed, they were actually a candidate for listing as threatened, and they were deemed to be more abundant than previously thought. And that's really in part because the Sonoran Gila monster is relatively abundant. My colleagues that work in Arizona, they kind of have a ongoing joke with me. They'll be like, how many Gila monsters did you see this year? I'm like, five. And they're like, we saw five last week. So they're definitely more abundant. There are different subspecies. We don't know a lot about the molecular DNA, so whether or not they actually, you know, share some connectivity is kind of an unknown. 2010, Gilas were petitioned to be listed in Utah, which would be very closely related to the monsters we have here. But it was not warranted because it's not a distinct population segment. So the crazy thing is we don't really know a lot about genetics. And so one thing we're trying to do is any monster that we can get in hand, we take a blood sample from. And that goes to, we bank that stuff. And ultimately, we hope to kind of reveal how closely related our Gila monsters in Nevada are to Utah's Gila monsters and Arizona's, because like I said, you know, they are a top carnivore, and we don't really know a lot about their status. They're so secretive. So one thing we're trying to do from a conservation perspective is kind of couple up the studies we do on Gila monsters with desert tortoises and rattlesnakes. Because if you think about it, the desert tortoise is the largest reptile on our landscape, and the Gila monster is a pretty close second or third, and then rattlesnakes. We get some big rattlesnakes here. So if you go from like this sliding scale of like threatened to relatively what we perceive as common, like a speckled rattlesnake, and kind of the unknown, you know, we've got a good range of big-bodied reptiles that are everywhere from threatened to common. And so we're hoping to see how these guys, when we put transmitters on tortoises, in Gila monsters, in rattlesnakes, see how they utilize the landscape, how they interact with one another. And also talking about that whole climate change vulnerability, when we put transmitters, we also glue on these little transmitters, these eye buttons onto tortoises, implant rattlesnakes and Gila monsters with these eye buttons, so we can get this kind of thermal signature to see whether or not they're all kind of using the environment the same way, and how when we start predicting how climate change will affect them, how these guys will shake out. Will rattlesnakes still be common? Probably. Will Gila monsters? We don't know. Will desert tortoise? That's a good question. So, you know, given that these guys do occupy kind of a similar niche in the shelter sense, I think this is a pretty good opportunity to look at how some of the changes that are going on the landscape will affect these critters. And also, you know, what's cool is we're coupling up with USGS. I think Todd Eskew has given talk at Tortoise Group before. I don't know if he talked about corridor use, but they're looking at cool stuff like how tortoises use mountain corridors to get through, to get to other populations. So we're working with some of those corridors, monitoring Gila monsters as well. Like I said, we really don't know a lot about genetics. And if you notice, Nevada only had one sample ran in this whole genetic study. That's nothing. So we're really hoping to beef that up. And we're also trying to get it habitat use. What's a good habitat? And when we can get good habitat, we can model that across the landscape, and we can start predicting where good habitat would be. So when solar developments or whatever put in applications, we can guide them away from areas that are important for tortoises, Gila monsters, and the like. And then I think this is kind of cool. This just kind of came up. Turns out that a collaborator of ours was interested in looking at venom with speckled rattlesnakes. And so some of the speckled rattlesnakes we're actually monitoring out there on the landscape with Gilas and tortoises, he's taking venom samples from, and he's looking at the venom constituents and how that changes in a range of a rattlesnake. So when you live in Baja and, say, St. George, Utah, you're interacting with different critters. You're probably eating different food items, and your venom is probably very focused on the prey that's available for you. So we're able to kind of see how that venom composition changes, which might have application in terms of other medical fields. And then kind of last but not least, you know, we don't really know a lot about water storage in Gila monsters and leaky skin, but we do know that they're way more vulnerable on the landscape when it comes to water. And so, you know, there's a lot of unknowns, and with sinking water levels at Lake Mead, I think that's just a good kind of canary in the coal mine. You know, it's definitely high time for us to kind of figure some of this stuff out, because, you know, we're not gaining more habitat, we're losing it. So, and this is kind of an interesting video, if you wouldn't mind clicking on this. Might be depressing, but this is Las Vegas in 1972. And this is Washington County in Utah, and this is primetime Gila monster habitat. This is actually right adjacent to where Dan Beck did a lot of his research. And you can see, I mean, we know Gila monsters occur at Red Rock. We know houses are occurring more frequently at and near Red Rock. And you can just see, you know, this is definitely changing not only probably the way critters interact with the landscape, but their ability to move across the landscape and connect with other populations, which again comes down to kind of a genetic question. So last but not least, this is kind of an ambitious call, but there's a fellow named Lawrence Klauber. Have any of you guys heard of Lawrence Klauber? Okay, so Lawrence Klauber was a sign salesman early on for San Diego Gas and Electric. And he worked his way up to become the CEO of San Diego Gas and Electric. I think that's a pretty amazing feat in and of itself. So I'm just gonna end my talk. No. What he ultimately did was not only pick up like 50,000 different specimens for museums, reptile and amphibian specimens, he also described over 56 different species. During the time he was working as a sign salesman to a CEO level, and he also wrote the Bible on rattlesnakes, which is a two-volume Bible, which still has stood the test of time. And he was a citizen scientist. He just did this for passion, right? He obviously was probably the guy that everyone called when they found a snake. But that just goes to show you, you know, when you study populations, you commonly think in the back of your head, like, an individual doesn't matter, you know, like, it's the population we're trying to protect. But I think this is a good example of an individual that truly mattered. And I imagine that all of you are passionate about things you do. And if you guys are interested in helping with reptile conservation or even Gila monster stuff, definitely talk to me, because I'm amazed. The volunteers that I have currently have largely done, I would say, 60 to 80% of the Gila monster work that we do is volunteer driven. And it's just awesome. I'm one person in the entire state that does reptiles. And so I heavily rely on people who are just passionate and excited and just need, you know, hey, go that way, you know, need a little direction. And I would love to collaborate with any and all of you. And kind of some of the things that we do with citizen science, you know, I commonly get people walking up photographing monsters at Valley Fire and then giving them to the state park, and they send them to me. And what's interesting, and I was talking to some folks earlier, that the population that was studying Valley Fire almost 15 years ago, we occasionally see Gila monsters from that study still within their home range, because someone took time to take a photo of a Gila monster and give it to us. And the reason we're able to identify which monster is which is because each monster has a unique banding pattern, much like your fingerprint. So when I get a photo of a Gila monster, I'm a geek. I just like scrolling through like my little book of Gila monsters, just kind of like whale flukes, you know, like trying to find if we've ever seen that monster before and where we saw it last. And it's impressive. So we found that this one monster, 15 years later, was still living in his home, was still within his home range. So that not only gives us an indication that an adult Gila monster can live for 15 plus years, so maybe it's 25, 30 years old, but also that home is home, you know? So when you remove an animal from home, that just adds a lot of complexity. But that's kind of a cool little note, and that's all because people take photos of stuff. So if you take photos of reptiles, send them to me. It's like great time for me, honestly. That there again, like you can see, there's like, I have the same thing for the populations I study. I have like this cheat sheet where I can go and I can look sometimes if I just get a tail photo, you know, you can be like, oh, those two dots, and that little band and those two dots, that's this monster. Bingo. So it's really cool. And also, you know, sadly, with road kills, you know, we have a lot of roads, and you think back to like 50s and whatnot, there weren't that many roads. And it seems like every year we get more roads, and we're just kind of causing small islands, essentially, with roads. And roads are hard to cross for any critter, especially when roads, you know, allow you to go 80 miles an hour. There's no way you can, you know, people hit tortoises. People hit all these things that are very visible in the road, but it's just really difficult for critters to cross the road, and there's a high mortality associated with that. But the one nice thing is when people do find Gila monsters, they usually call us, and I gladly take them. We accession them into a museum, and that information gives us indications as to what they're eating, sexual maturity. It gives us all sorts of cool measurements that otherwise we would just never get. And so, although it's really sad to see it, if you guys are interested, if you guys like dead things, I know it sounds a little morbid, but I have a freezer full of reptiles, and every year I travel and drop them off at a museum. We have a pickle party. We take genetic samples. We do all this cool stuff with a variety of different reptiles, tortoises included, when we find them dead in the wild. And it just provides us with more information about the critters that we maybe take for granted or that we seldom see. And so last but not least, there's actually the male monster I was telling you about that I'm pretty sure lost the battle. He's passed out right here at the base of a yucca. But they are illegal to harass, touch, capture, obviously own. And that's the case anywhere they occur. So California, Nevada, Utah, Arizona, New Mexico. But you know, let sleeping monsters lie. They are venomous too, but definitely take photos. They're unlike maybe a rattlesnake, which might get a little more aggressive if you get too close. Gila monsters, their first thing is being camouflaged, or at least hiding in places. Next thing is they'll hiss, and then they'll kind of open their mouth, and they will readily bite you if you are 20, drinking tequila, and have testosterone. So don't say, hold my beer and watch this, because you'll get bit. But take photos, please. And in this day and age where people have cameras on their phones, it's just amazing the information that we're now getting. And that's that. So thank you so much for letting me come and chat with you on a Saturday. Oh yeah. Should I, you want to put, should we put that little video on? And okay. I don't know how much time we have. I tend to run over. Does anyone have any questions? Yes. Where do I hang out? In terms of, what's that?
What?
Border office.
Oh, I was like, I hang out. It's on Vegas Drive in Decatur. Kind of went alleys almost to get them, but. Yes, so life in a desert hole. That right there. Yep. This is a little video I put together on camera trapping. I call it camera trapping.
Is there something with it or not?
There is.
Bring it on the other side. That way I don't hopefully stay away from the Yeah, don't
yeah,
just move it out right now. Tone it down just a little.
Yeah. But yeah, this is just a stationary camera. We just mount them in front of tortoise burrows.
Let's do it.
Let's give Jason one more round of applause. That was just phenomenal. Thank you very, very much, Jason. He's getting Nessie.
So this is a smaller female Gila monster.
She's cute.
How fast are they?
Surprisingly fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they're not like a small lizard, like, darting fast, but I've been impressed. The other day when I was tracking one of them that was on the move, I set something down to, like, I went to pick up a different camera, and, like, literally had to, like, I was, like, frantically searching for, like, where did I go? Where did I go? And it had moved maybe 30 meters. Like, and they, like, the way they move is, they're kind of, they just kind of have that lumber to them. It's really interesting, and they just kind of waddle, but they're pretty fast. And those two males, when they have an incentive to really move fast, they can definitely dart. Like, for instance, when you go, if you're like talking with somebody and you come across the Gila monster, usually they've heard you, and they're really fast to dart back into a hole.
Can you keep those pets?
You cannot.
No.
State of Nevada. Other states, like staying outside of their range, they're allowed, but you know, a lot of counties don't allow venomous reptiles to be kept. So it's kind of one of those things. They're definitely in that category where, depending on the state, they might allow it. Like for instance, Nevada, we allow people to keep rattlesnakes, but I recently found that Clark County and Las Vegas City did not allow residents to keep venomous rattlesnakes, like to keep rattlesnakes.